28-year-old Constable Matt Hunt was killed in the line of duty last year. His whānau and friends were left reeling, and the nation joined them in an outpouring of grief for the young officer. Now Matt's mum, Diane Hunt, is telling her story for the first time, and she's calling for change in policing in the face of growing gun violence. This from Matt Chisholm.
There are people out there that want them dead just because of their uniform.
I just put up my hands, sort of to show I didn't have a gun. He just like made a decision, and it was just like, I'm gonna kill you.
He's taken my best mate, who I will never see again, and he doesn't care.
It's taken Diane Hunt more than a year to open these boxes.
Amazing, isn't it?
And read the thousands of messages of support that flooded in.
Dear Constable Matthew Hunt, thank you for trying hard to protect Massey.
After her son, Matt, was killed in the line of duty.
A true hero will be remembered for his service, dedication and bravery.
Diane, how is it for you going through some of this stuff?
It's still hard to believe that it's happened and that this had to happen to Matthew.
Does it make it any easier that so many people have talked about such a great young man with so much potential?
Yes, it does. Then it's so sad that he never got to fulfil it. Good morning, main reception. Diane speaking.
Diane Hunt's always been a worker. She brought up Matt and his younger sister Ellie as a single parent. Money was tight, but there was a lot of love.
Matthew was always very strong-willed. He was very sure of himself in as much as what he wanted to do and what he didn't want to do. But, I mean, he was a wonderful baby, child, young man. You know, he was, but if he didn't want to do something, he wasn't going to do it.
Where do you think he got that from?
Must have been me, maybe.
Was he ever a little naughty?
Of course, yeah. He was. Mm. I mean, we would get frustrated at each other. But he wasn't an angry boy. He had a very even temperament. So many ways he was an easy boy to raise. Mm.
Without a dad at home, Matt spent a lot of time with his best mates.
We grew up with him. Like, we're him and he's us. Like, we became each other because of just, we spent all our time together.
Sam Swaffield and Regan Green.
Oh, he was honestly the best bloke going round, eh? Like, so laid back, and he didn't say much, but when he did, it was worth listening to. He was the bloke that you always wanted around, you know, he was the first one that Sam and I would text if there was an All Blacks game on.
You might remember Sam and Regan from our Sunday story last year and how they decided to run a series of half marathons in Matt's honour.
We came out of the blocks with a head of steam up on the one that you came with us to in Taupo.
Every run was slower after that. I lost the use of both knees for a good few months there where I just couldn't walk up the stairs properly.
Please don't take this the wrong way. I think we're close enough now for me to throw this at you. Do you think you're built for running?
No. I finished my rugby career as a prop for a reason.
They're brothers. You know, I mean, Matthew fitted into their families and, you know, he was always welcome at their homes. And, yes, they all love him.
The trio played, partied, travelled the world together, but Matt always had his future mapped out.
From an early age, he wanted to be a police officer.
And how did you feel about Matt wanting to become a policeman?
Well, I was always really proud of his choice. I could see that there was a career through policing and, I encouraged him.
Matt applied to join the New Zealand Police and was turned down, so he set about making sure next time he'd be a shoo-in.
He worked for the courts and then he worked for corrections, and they opened the door to more people joining police.
And how proud were you when he graduated?
Extremely.
And when Matt took up his first police posting on Auckland's North Shore, life couldn't have been better for mother and son.
Was Matt the most important man in your life?
He was. More and more, he was becoming someone I could rely on. And he would tell me he was proud of me.
How nice was it hearing your son say that?
It was wonderful.
Matt saw his mates entering adulthood.
Sam, myself and Matt, we made a pact to be each other's best men. It was something we planned together, and I guess it just shows how close we really were. And I don't think many people have that bond that us three had.
And Matt's career was blossoming too.
He was going places. He, you know, became a constable, and so he could progress, and that's how he ended up in the frontline role in June 2020.
Di, did he ever talk to you about how safe or unsafe it was out there?
Not really, no.
Maybe he didn't want his mum to worry, but Matt did confide in his mates.
He talked about how things were changing, that there was definitely more gun crime, or more people out there who had guns and who were actually using them. Like he was definitely becoming aware of the dangers.
Matt gave me a visit, and it was one of the last times I saw him. And I haven't even told Sam this before. We were talking about his uniform and his sabre and stuff. And he said, "You could stab me, but if you shoot me, I'm buggered." And we kind of, you know, just shrugged it off, laughed about it. And I don't think I considered that there was a real risk. Because we live in New Zealand, you know? It's so safe, that stuff doesn't happen here.
Breaking news, police are responding to a critical incident in the West Auckland suburb of Massey.
I was watching it on the news feed and I just sort of got lulled into a sense of it was somebody else, because they would have told me, and then a knock on the door, and I knew. As soon as I opened it, I knew.
Matt's life cut short by 25-year-old gunman Eli Epiha during a routine traffic stop. The officer with him seriously injured. They had no way of defending themselves.
It's just your whole world is gone. You know, like, I'm so proud of him. And he was the best of me. And he made me proud. You know, the police asked me what I wanted. Did we want a private service or a public service? And Matthew was proud to wear that uniform, and I couldn't take that part of his life away from him. He'd died for that uniform. And so I said yes.
To see him up in lights across the country and people talking about him and everyone knowing his name, it's a really weird kind of concept, because he was quite in some sense, quite an introverted person.
Di, how much of a hole has he left?
Well, I have no idea what I'm supposed to do now. Do you know what I mean? Like, I mean, I needed him in my life. You know, all the milestones that anybody would want for their children, I was looking forward to seeing those and with him. And it seems extremely unfair that he didn't get to be a grown man.
13 months after Matt Hunt's death, it's finally come down to this, the trial of his killer at the Auckland High Court.
I promised myself that I'd go there every day, and I did.
That can't have been easy.
No, it was pretty horrible. But we were there for Matthew.
It's the first time they'd hear the full facts of that tragic day. The first time the family would come face to face with Eli Epiha.
How was his demeanour?
Careless, carefree. He had a strut. He's taken my best mate, who I will never see again, and he doesn't care. I've got zero compassion for him.
It's easier to show compassion to people in society when it's not personal.
A week before the trial, Epiha had changed his plea to guilty of the murder of Matt Hunt.
It's got a magazine.
Now he was in court facing a charge of attempting to murder Matt's partner that day, Constable David Goldfinch.
What was it that you and Constable Hunt were doing that morning?
Speed checks, licence checks, just your regular day of policing, as far as traffic goes.
Were you uniformed?
We were, full uniform.
Constable Goldfinch described how he and Matt Hunt caught up to Eli Epiha's car after he'd fled their West Auckland traffic stop and crashed.
He was walking towards me and he was holding a firearm. I just put up my hands, sort of to show I didn't have a gun. I said, "F***ing stop, bro. Put the f***ing gun down." Was that effect? And he just started pulling the trigger, firing bullets at me.
Goldfinch ran across the road and took cover behind a parked car.
And then, after like a few seconds, he just kind of went, like his head just kind of clicked. Like he just kind of, and it was like, he just like made a decision. And it was just like, "I'm gonna kill you."
What did you do?
I ran.
Epiha opened fire again.
I don't know how the bullet missed. And I don't know what it hit, but it was like concrete or a driveway or something, because it was just a shower of shrapnel. A bullet hit me straight in the hip, and it just felt like an explosion of acid.
Shot four times, Goldfinch kept running, down driveways, through backyards, over fences, till he could stop.
There was just blood everywhere, and I just called into comms and said, "I've been shot."
"Officer shot, officer on the ground, you need ambulance immediately." "Where are you, bro? Let us know where you are."
I've been shot by a gun. I'd lost a lot of blood, and I started to kind of lose feeling in my hands. And I thought I was going to die. And still didn't know where Matt was.
As Epiha watched Goldfinch disappear, an unarmed Matt Hunt was getting out of the police car back up the hill.
"What made you think you had to shoot Constable Hunt?"
That's just how it happened. I didn't think.
"You only shoot at Constable Hunt four times, don't you?"
I think so.
"There's no need to shoot him anymore, is there? Because he's on the ground dying in front of you, isn't it? You just leave him there, eh? Don't you?"
Yeah.
"Job done, so to speak."
Epiha fired 14 times in a rampage that lasted just 32 seconds. Shortly after, Epiha fled the scene, driven by a woman from a neighbouring house.
The person that's done this knows that the police officers he's pointing a gun at have nothing.
Did Constables Goldfinch and Hunt have arms in their car on that fateful day in June?
My understanding, there was firearms in the lockbox in the vehicle and also in the lockbox in the boot.
Chris Cahill heads up the New Zealand Police Association, the police union. He's a former frontline cop.
So when Hunt and Goldfinch faced Epiha and his weapons that day, what were their options?
They really had no option but to run or to hide, because the option of getting the firearms out of the vehicle is too slow an option to make them safe.
That has other frontline cops worried.
44 officers have either had a firearm presented at them or fired at them in the last 2 years. So you'd have to say there's a willingness to shoot police officers that I don't believe has existed to the level in the history that I've been in the police.
In May, the Police Association surveyed over 6,000 frontline police officers and asked them if they wanted to carry sidearms.
77% want to be generally armed. 79% of road policing officers who normally work alone want to be generally armed. They're incredibly high numbers.
So what do you say to your frontline officers when 77% of them want to carry firearms?
Look, I totally understand that perspective. It is entirely natural when you imagine yourself on the wrong end of a firearm to think that you would want to be armed.
Police Commissioner Andrew Costa.
Are you the person who decides whether our frontline police carry weapons?
Technically, it is my decision. But I'm just not of the view that general arming is the solution that we should select to make our people safer.
Do you think New Zealand will be less safe if our police carry firearms?
The evidence that we can get on this is that where police are armed, it's equivocal as to whether police are safer, so it's not clear police are safer, and more people are shot.
For Costa, this is personal.
I agonise over this, not least of all because I've got a son who wants to join the police. I know that the decisions I'm taking now will have an impact for his safety and the safety of all of our people. You can't win here. You can decide to arm our people and have negative consequences from that, which is what I believe will be the outcome, or you can not arm and run the risk that we have another situation where something's gone wrong.
Do you think if Matt and David had arms on them that day, that that would have made a difference?
Perhaps if they did have something to respond with, the outcome might have been different.
After 2 days of deliberation, the jury finally came back to a packed High Court with a decision.
Do 11 of you find the defendant, Eli Bob Zoeni Epiha, guilty or not guilty of charge one, the charge of attempted murder?
Guilty.
The loss of Matt has been made all the more traumatic by having to hear every possible detail that happened that day. Our thoughts are with Dave and his family, and we would like to acknowledge his incredible courage. We hope that no other police family will ever have to go through this.
3 days later, on a winter's night in Auckland, the Hunt family gathered to celebrate what would have been Matt Hunt's 30th birthday.
To be fair, he wouldn't have organised anything because he's useless like that.
Yeah, 100%.
A moment that he would have loved.
Yeah.
Just another one where he's not going to be there.
What advice do you think Matt would give you about looking forward?
It would just be, you know, keep carrying on sort of thing. He was pragmatic. He wouldn't want people to dwell on things, but...
Where do you think he got that from?
quite possibly his mother.
Well, Diane Hunt has taken a petition to Parliament. She wants no parole for offenders who kill police officers. Meanwhile, mates Sam and Regan are still running in Matt's honour.